All right. Hello, and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine, and Pipeliner CRM, joining you from a very sunny San Diego. What's new, I know you say, but it is very sunny today. And today I am joined by Lisa McLeod, who is in Atlanta, Georgia. How are you doing, Lisa?
I'm great.
Thank you. And Lisa is an advisor, consultant, and speaker who works with senior executives and sales teams around the world. And she's been featured in Forbes, Fortune, and the New York Times. And today we're going to talk about selling with noble purpose. Okay, Lisa, let's get right into it. A lot of times when people think about selling, noble purpose is probably not the two words that they would normally associate with it. So. So give me your, what is selling with noble purpose?
Well, we have an image that salespeople, the best salespeople, are manipulative and they talk people into doing things that they don't want to do. But actually, the research tells an entirely different story. Mm-hmm. Our research found that salespeople who sell with what we call noble purpose, who truly want to make a difference in their customers' lives, actually outsell the salespeople who are just focused on their own sales targets.
Yeah, that's. I think that's fascinating. And just to be clear here, everything you're talking about is based on actual research.
Mm-hmm. This is not a hunch. And The thing is, there's a lot of research now on this topic, but you need look no further than your own reaction to a manipulative salesperson to know the truth. And the challenge is so many well-intended people go into sales, but then their organization tells them in training, focus on the customer. But then they get out on the sales floor and it's hit the number. Mm-hmm. And so they become the worst, most fear-based, graspy versions of themselves, but it doesn't work.
Yeah. And it's funny because a lot of salespeople, like, you go home for the weekend and maybe they go somewhere and somebody's a really pushy salesperson and they're like, "Ugh, I hate this experience." But then on Monday morning, they've completely forgotten about that and they become that person.
Well, and let's be clear, there are some shysters out there. But What we found was the majority of well-intended salespeople, the reason that they think about their own quotas first versus what the customer is trying to accomplish isn't because they're bad people. It's sure. Because there's a boot on their neck and their bosses are hammering them quota, quota, quota. Whereas if their bosses changed the language, what would happen is you'd increase the sales.
Yeah. And I think, I mean, the experience is clear. I mean, from everybody's own personal experiences, when they come across a salesperson who really wants to help them, who really tries to understand what they're going through, you can very quickly move into that trusted advisor zone, you know, as opposed to somebody who is not as forthcoming, who is maybe a little pushier, maybe a little more desperate. And we don't like desperation, do we?
No. And if you've ever been, and I, when I wrote the first version of Selling with Noble Purpose, we were coming out of the recession. My husband's business had a bankruptcy. So I was really in danger of being that pushy, graspy salesperson because I needed money. And it wasn't because I was a bad person. It's just because I was broke.
Sure.
And so what our research told us, though, is that there are a couple of very distinct things that salespeople and their leadership that organizations can do to instill this sense of noble purpose in a sales team that will propel them forward.
Okay, so let's dig into some of those things.
So one example is super simple. Everyone listening to this call who's a salesperson or sales manager can do this. You're about to go on a customer call. What does your manager ask? They look at the pipeline report. What do they ask? When are you going to close it and how much is it going to be? Mm-hmm. All you have to do is ask one additional question. And the question is this: how will the customer be different as a result of doing business with us? If you ask that one question of a seller, or you ask it yourself, because I'm going in, I'm thinking, oh, $50,000, it's on the line, I've got to close it, $50 million, $50, whatever your number is. If I'm thinking, I got to close it, I'm going to close it. Where's my brain? It's on me.
Sure.
And if I say, how will the customer be different as a result of doing business with us? the whole conversation shifts. And we've used that. We've worked with over 24 companies implementing this model, not just the question. There's a couple of other things, but sure. That single question, we call it the game-changing question. When managers start asking it about deals, the win rate goes up, and it goes up quite dramatically and quite quickly.
Yeah, because what you're talking about there is you're crossing over the table and you're actually sitting in the shoes of the buyer, because you're really trying to understand, okay, from their point of view, what will our solution do to make their life better? And that means that, you know, that's where real empathy comes in, right?
That's right. And the thing is, I want to be really clear here. One of the things that we found, and we were implementing this with, as I said, a number of different firms, is when you tell salespeople, focus on the customer, focus on what's good for them, that's certainly better than not telling them that.
Sure.
But it's not specific enough. What we found is the real difference comes from asking that very specific question. How will the customer be different? Because if I say, what's the value, you can just repeat your marketing message and go, wow, 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 the half of our solution is blah, 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 blah. But if I say, how will this customer be different? Then your brain goes in a totally different direction and you have to get really clear. And if you don't know, that's a clue to the manager that you need more discovery. If the seller can't articulate how the customer will be different, it is not pitch time. It is discovery time.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think that's what it is. I mean, I think sometimes just helping a salesperson get out of their own way or get out of their head is all that's really needed, as you say. I mean, in a situation like this, to reorient their thinking, because you're 100% correct. They go in with a tremendous amount of pressure. And I'm sure there are lots of salespeople out there listening right now under pressure like they've never been under before. And their managers are under pressure like they've never been under before. So getting out of your own head is a really good thing.
Well, one thing they have to understand, your customers are under pressure. Like they've never been under pressure before, at least in the last decade. And one of the things that Selling with Noble Purpose answers is the growing chorus of customers who are asking companies, are you here to help me? Or are you just here to close me? Mm-hmm. And as you said, salespeople can be very well-intended, but what we found is this top 10% of sellers, having a noble purpose is innate to them, irrespective of what the company's doing. But what we found is those people in the middle, those people from the 20% to the 90%, that's where when you make these, we've got about 12 of them, tweaks that you make in their mindset and in their behavior, everything changes.
Yeah. And just think about that as a group of people that in, say, within your sales organization, if you have that group in the middle, you move them a couple of percentage points over, the revenue impact is massive.
Oh, it's huge. We've had people double revenue. When we worked with Hootsuite years ago, they were on a growth trajectory. They had to ramp up the whole world quickly, doubled revenue. We had a bank increase earnings by 40%. We had a travel company take their 25% growth, turn it into 35% growth. No change in personnel. They just made some tweaks to the sales language and some tweaks to what we call the sales ecosystem. And they had a dramatically different experience when they interacted with their customers.
And you mentioned there's a chapter in your book that you say where passion falls short, right? And I love that, because sometimes people equate, you know, if you care enough and you're really passionate about it, and, you know, you're passionate about your customers, that should be enough.
Well, it's better than not being passionate about it.
Sure, of course.
But there is some research on this as well. And what it tells us is the people with no passion and no purpose, they're the bottom performers. You don't want them. High passion, high purpose, that's who you want. But here's where it gets really interesting. If you have high passion, but no sense of purpose, you're not going to perform as well as the person who has high sense of purpose, but no passion. And I'll give you a perfect example. You're coming home at the end of the day, you're exhausted, your kids are waiting at the door. A person who's all excited about being a parent, their passion's going to wane at the end of that 12-hour day. But a person who knows, I might not be excited right now, but this matters. This moment matters. I have no passion left, but I've got a sense of purpose. You will do it. Because that's the thing. Passion is individual. It's about you. And it wanes often in the face of difficult circumstances. Purpose is more steadfast, and it's shared. So if you're trying to hire people and you go out, find a bunch of passionate people isn't going to be the best thing for you. Finding people with a sense of purpose and then scaling that sense of purpose around how do you make a difference to customers, that's going to see you through a time like we're going through right now.
Yeah, absolutely. So how do you go about, you say naming and claiming your noble sales purpose. How do you go about finding and crafting what your noble sales purpose is?
Well, the good news is if you are selling something and your customers are buying it, you probably already have one. It is inside your organization right now. And so the way you find it is by answering what we call the three discovery questions. How do you make a difference? How do you do it differently than your competition? And on your best day, what do you love about your job? And the language on those three questions is really important. We really worked with this because a lot of companies have value proposition.
Sure.
Or a lot of companies have goals. A value proposition is our services provide blah, 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 blah. A goal is we're going to be the number one provider. Your noble purpose is different. So I'll give you some examples. When we asked that question amongst a group of bankers, Atlantic Capital Bank in Atlanta, they're a commercial bank. When we asked, it was really obvious that they were passionate about their customers' success. And they were also very purposeful in the sense that they were really, when they worked with customers, they did very deep discovery. They spent a lot of time nurturing their customers along. And so their noble purpose is we fuel prosperity. Simple statement. We worked with the team at Dave & Buster's that does corporate sales, where they go sell you on coming to Dave & Buster's for your event. Their noble purpose is we champion laugh out loud fun. And so there are two very different things, but where they found it was answering those questions. How do you make a difference to your customers? And how do you do it differently? When we were at the meeting at Dave & Buster's, they were like, well, I'll tell you how we do it differently, because people have fun here and they laugh here. And if they're not laughing, we go over and figure out how to make them laugh. And so it comes out from those conversations.
Yeah, and I love that. I love the Dave & Buster's example is a fantastic one, because it I think for everyone, it conjures up that image, because you imagine if you had a group that came in and it's silence and they're not saying anything and they've got long faces, you'd be like, oh my goodness. And so the contrast is a fantastic one there. But I also love the idea that you say is if you have customers today and if you have happy customers today, you have your purpose is there. You just have to identify it, give it a name and bring it to the fore.
Yeah, name it and claim it, because your purpose does a lot of things for you, but at a basic level, it defines your aim and your lane. So Dave & Buster's, we champion laugh out loud fun. Our aim is to be the champions and our lane is laugh out loud fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Atlantic Capital Bank, we fuel prosperity. Our aim is to fuel it in our customers. We're not going to completely create it because it's the customer's business, but we're going to fuel it and our lane is prosperity. And the reason that this is so important is imagine the difference between me telling a person that's going to go out and close a bunch of commercial loans, your job is to close these loans, pay attention to the customer, really listen, versus I look that person in the eye and say, we fuel prosperity. You go find out what prosperity means to these customers. You figure out how we can fuel it. Like, that person is going in a completely different sales rep. So it's much more than a tagline, but you got to get the line right so you can activate the behavior.
And is this why, and I love your chapter title here, is this why you say specificity is sexy?
Yes. Saying we want.
Sorry, that one just happens to jump out.
Specificity is sexy. So for everyone wanting to know how to sex up their sales calls, get more specific. Woohoo! Yeah, that tells you what kind of nerd I am. But the thing is, oftentimes we're very vague when we say we want you to help the customer, provide value to the customer, listen to the customer. That doesn't make people's hearts beat faster and it doesn't point in the right direction. So that's why you want to get really clear on how you are making a difference to customers. And that challenge to do it in a very small amount of words. We just had a company and their noble purpose that they landed on, I can't say it yet, who they are because it's not public yet, but it was we propel our customers' highest aspirations.
Man.
And so every time you go in to meet with a customer, you got to find out what their highest aspirations are.
Aspiration is, and how you can propel it.
And that's a company that had a lot of different products. But the more you can be clear with your sellers, what you want to do is you want to make your noble purpose as clear and present in your organization as your sales targets are.
Yeah.
Because they are very clear and present and specific. You want to make
clear
it
present
just,
danger.
Yeah, just as clear how we expect you to make a difference to customers and make that part of the organizational groundwater.
Yeah, no, I really like that because it also gives you somewhere to come back to ground yourself, right? When everything gets chaotic, when things, as we know, I mean, a lot of sales interactions and sales processes can go in many different directions, and there's peaks and valleys and there's curveballs and any other cliche I can think of comes into this. And sometimes you need something to refocus and ground yourself in. And I think, as you say, if you have that noble purpose, if it's very specific, you can always, you know, bring yourself back there and sort of cast aside the noise.
Yeah, there was a really great study, a recent study from Michigan State University, Dr. Valerie Good, who discovered that salespeople with this noble purpose are more tenacious. They're more resilient. They put forth more effort over time. Because again, if I am looking at my parenting and thinking every day, I got to wake up, I got to make the food, I got to do this, I got to do that, that's going to be a grind. But if I have something to ground myself on, if I believe I'm creating future leaders, that's something to tether myself to. And it's so important now, because if your sales team is only tethered to the number, you're not going to have a very resilient sales team. In all likelihood, there are going to be some challenges in hitting that number this year. And so you want your sales team tethered to something bigger than a number. You want them tethered to how they make a difference to customers.
Yeah. And that's, and then as I said, that gives them the opportunity when, if the sale isn't going that well, or the process isn't going that well, that they can actually work with the customer to come back to that. Right, to come back to what difference it makes to them, what's your purpose, and it gets everybody a little grounded again.
And it does, because so many salespeople, they're going to face rejection. They're going to face rejection in situations where maybe there is still opportunity because the customer is going through who knows what they're going through.
Sure.
But if you are tenacious on, I am here to improve the customer, and this particular thing doesn't work out, you do have something to go back to.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, listen, this has been fantastic. I love the concepts in this. I love the idea of selling with noble purpose. I love the fact that it's such a great grounding tool for people. So all of Lisa's information will be in the contributor bio here. And the book, by the way, is called Selling with Purpose. It's one of a number of books and Lisa has, Selling with Purpose. And you have Forget Perfect, The Triangle of Truth, Feeding Grace, and so many other books. I don't know, you're on fire. So before we go, Lisa, please do tell people a little bit more about yourself and what you do.
So I do a couple of things besides writing. We work with organizations on sales transformation, taking sales teams from transactional to high impact, longer term customer relationships. As you said, it's kind of an overused phrase, but that trusted advisor. And we've been really successful in helping a number of sales teams get there, because the secret is twofold. It's improving competitive differentiation and it's accelerating emotional engagement. And that's where we work. Our work falls at the intersection of sales, strategy, and culture, because you've got to have all three of those things, a clear sales pipeline, to use your word, a clear vision of where you're going with sales, clear strategy, and then you also have to embed it in your culture. And so we work with organizations all over the world on that.
Yeah, and to be perfectly honest, I think that this is the right time for organizations to take a look at things like selling with noble purpose, because I do think as we emerge from this pandemic, I do think there are going to be some fundamental changes. But most of all, I think people are going to crave, and customers are going to crave, more of that personal human touch, and the trust factor is going to be even higher than it's been before. And I think that they're going to gravitate towards the very type of sellers that you're talking about, people who are selling with noble purpose.
The data confirms what we already know in our hearts to be true. Customers are asking, are you here to help me or are you just here to close me? And I'll tell you, there's another group of people that's asking that too. And that's the salespeople themselves. Yeah. Because when they all went home and they had to sit at their kitchen table and make sales calls, if they didn't feel a sense of purpose about what they were doing, you weren't going to win their hearts and minds. And you can't win the hearts and minds of your customers if you don't have the hearts and minds of your sellers.
That's beautiful. Well, beautiful closing. Thank you so much. So again, thank you, Lisa. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. I'll see you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.